not be televised.
Yo. Truth is, the youth is, the future. Need to show them different, not what we used to. So tell a friend, tune in, the school's in. Don't be offended, my humble opinion. Gotta come together, change for the better. Better chatter, put you through the sweater, only get your letters. Felt the pressure, ancestors gave their life for us to make it right, not for giving up the fight. Shining light so bright, if we all unite, the time right, time now, for new heights.
It's a bird, it's a plane, Superman, no. Keys and Q kicking knowledge for your brain. Hope is what we giving, truth is what we spitting. Proof is in the pudding, so you just gotta listen and comprehend. This is my humble opinion. We here to spread real, no pretending.
Yes, you know, yes, you know.
Slavery wasn't just an institution. It was an ideology. It was an ideology on how they felt about the black body. And that ideology still carries. How do you change an ideology of a people? Everything that we see today, and I use this term frequently, is anti-black. You turn on the television, you might hear a rap song that's talking about killing another black person. You hear, you watch certain television shows, you have bad black relationships, brothers and sisters yelling at each other. How do you, like literally, how do you change an ideology? I don't think that you or I don't think we can change that ideology. I think the only thing that we can do is create an environment to where if these things were ever to happen, you know, black people could have, we could take advantage of them in the best possible way. I think that's the only thing we can do. But the idea, I think that when you have an ideology of a group that literally you have a sector of people that feel this certain way, and people can say that they don't think that way. I'm going to take it back to one thing you said a little bit early, and then we'll get on, we're done. I need these pastors.
Yeah.
If you're real, honestly, it can't just be black pastors talking about, hey, these people are being mistreated. I don't need you going to Rwanda or to Africa saving the black children here. We got kids over here that need help. And you're saying you're representing the faith? I'll call you out directly. Where are you? Where are you speaking about these issues?
That's right. What happened to the pastors, like that march, you know, with the leaders and weren't just in the pulpit?
I'm just saying, and if this was, and a lot of these pastors, a lot of these guys, man, they're theologians. I'm saying if you're speaking, you're standing on a platform that people shouldn't be mistreated, and that's what quote unquote Christ was talking about, then why are you not, you have a segment of the population that has been being mistreated for the last 500 years in this part of the world.
Right.
And I don't see anybody being so abrupt, except that that's why I said the change can't come from us. The change has to come from other people. And I just see no evidence, because what's their advantage for changing their behavior?
Now, shout out to the pastors, you know, who are out there.
There are some, but there should be, honestly, there should be flocks.
Right, but you saw what happened to Reverend Jeremiah Wright when he stood up. Oh, Lord.
But you understand, that shows you who's in charge. Because this is a political party. But we need people, and that's not calling any pastor, but I'm just saying, if you're really standing for faith and everyone is created equal, and there are many pastors that you look at their churches and the demographics of that, you know, somebody said years ago, church is the most segregated portion of our week. Everybody goes this way and that way, but everybody love the same God. God, same person. But no. And I mean, in the black community, we have all these churches. So I'm not down in the black pastors. I'm saying, if any pastor, if you have the opportunity to have a voice, this should be a topic for as much violence as we have in these communities, as much fighting as we do, as much people being mistreated, as much people are hungry. All these are things that Christ had talked about. I don't see any evidence, yeah, on a small scale, but where's the national scale saying, hey, look, man, we've got a system, and this thing is not working. Nobody is no person is the type of person that any of us should be, and we can all be better, but we have to totally destroy. Really, Charles, if we really look at it, the whole thing needs to be destroyed. The whole thing needs to be turned upside down. Because does any black person in this country understand how it feels to not be considered black? When you grow up here, you walk around. I mean, you can be 5 years old. You immediately know there's a difference. And one other thing, and you know, I get long winded. I believe that I honestly believe, and I heard this from a lady named Pam. She wrote this book called Trojan Horse: Death of a Dark Nation. You should pick it up. She said that the black church is literally a cry for help. They're so packed every Sunday. Because black people inherently know something is not right. They are packed. I mean, think about it. They pack every Sunday. People just begging and crying for help. And honestly, they might cry for Christ. And I know people, but I think they're crying for something else too. Because they're because they're inherently feeling something is not correct about where I'm at in my life. And I'm observing all these things, and something is not right. And they are crying and begging and pleading for some sort of help. And for sure. Are they getting it or are they not getting it? I don't know. But, you know, since our ancestors came here, we're still crying.
And if we look at the history of speaking in tongues, there was a reason that happened. Like, that was a transformation into something new. So if you're speaking in tongues every single Sunday...
You may
want to check that. Check that theology.
I don't get into
that. We ain't going too deep in that one.
Man, but I'm just saying it's a cry, particularly in the African American. I just believe, man, it's a cry and it's a beg for help because inherently people know something is wrong with where we are over here. I mean, it could be worldwide, but here, something inherently is wrong and you feel it. And you know it.
Yeah, now that ideology piece, let me tell you something real quick that I had sort of led at a church that I'm a member of. Is there were, the church fans. You know, the church fans.
Right. All right, they got Charles funeral home.
So, all right. So the pictures on some of these fans was, and you were talking about the ideology, was a depiction of deities and, of Jesus that was not accurate with any scripture that's in the Bible, right?
Okay.
So I disposed of said fans and felt no bad way about it because I think that's a big part of the ideology. And the same thing happened with the other pictures, and murals in this particular facility. And I know of other people who do this as well. Because it's one thing to say, okay, like when we think about spirituality, we're not thinking about a color, we're looking at a color. But it's very, and I won't even argue that point if we're being fair about it, but if we're going to say that, but then still depict Jesus in a light that has no historical fact to it, then I take issue because that is part of this mental stigma that we have because of our ideological, education.
There's no human way possible that if you go through Sunday school as a child for 10, 12 years of your life and every depiction that you see is of a white Christ, that you don't grow up believing that God is white. And therefore, anybody else associated with that is the same thing, that they're God. And then everything else that's not is bad. That's anti-black. And that's why it goes back to the whole thing needs to be, whoever made the depiction of Christ, Michelangelo, I don't know, one of those guys. Dude, that was thousands of years ago. If we're progressive, then the people that are in charge of this, the theologians, change it. If that's not an accurate depiction, change it. Just change it. If it's not an accurate depiction and you have evidence, change it. Why is that so difficult to do?
There you go. That's what we're about here. Change.
Change. There you go.
Brother Aaron Simmons, I couldn't end it any better. This is, in my humble opinion, 101 Jams.
You're listening to In My Humble Opinion
with Maxilia Robinson and Charles Lewis. Only on 101.3 Jams.
A great citizen of the earth, I will say. Mrs. Mary Grace. She is always about the business of helping others across this globe. Mary, how are you today?
Oh, I'm blessed, Charles. I'm grateful, just very grateful about a lot of things in life.
Good.
Great. You know, the reason that we called you, and for our listeners, you know, that it's an ongoing report and developments from August 12th, the unfortunate events that transpired here in the city. And so for those who don't know, there's a pretty famous picture right now of you with the gentleman resting his head on you, and you are giving him water. And I believe there's another picture of you administering first aid. And so how about we start with you kind of just giving our listeners the background, the backdrop of why you were downtown Charlottesville on August 12th. What brought you there?
Well, my husband and I raised our kids there, and I've known you since our son was four. And I've always just so admired and loved you. You've just always been a wonderful person.
You paid her.
So we were back visiting. I've had my husband down in Durham, North Carolina, for medical care at Duke University since January. But we had the opportunity to come up and visit, and it just happened to be when this rude divide people rally was going to take place. So I was grateful to have the opportunity to show up. And during the night before the rally, I knew I wanted to go and stand against what was going on as a counter demonstrator, but I also felt that I wanted to be a nonviolent witness for love.
Mm-hmm.
So during the night, I woke up and got my Virginia Organizing t-shirt out, and I wrote the word love on it,
mm-hmm.
and put 1 John 4:7-8, which is a passage that I really like a lot from the New Testament. And that says, "For love is of beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and mm-hmm. all love know God, and mm-hmm. God knows them."
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And it's just such a wonderful passage, and I thought that would be a good one to share that day.
Whatever you think our listeners would benefit from, that they may not be seeing, you know, on the national news, or, you know, the side of the love and compassion that you showed that's not being shown publicly on news outlets.
Yeah, it's fascinating to me. I mean, violence is a very, I don't know, sexy. Mm-hmm. A lot of people will tune in when they hear about something violent. But my concern was that I really believe these guys are hurting. I mean, they talk about their fears. They use the word fear. They are afraid,
yeah. mm-hmm.
that their poor white race is being neglected, and I mean, I wonder what happened to these people when they were kids. What did they go through?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I stand in a place of white privilege as a woman, and I tried to raise my son in a way that would help him recognize that it's not all about him,
mm-hmm.
and that people are suffering, and I just don't know what kind of parenting went into these people who came to demonstrate.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
When I got there, I was standing in a, I generally was standing near where the Nazis were, right? The mm-hmm. KKK Nazi people.
Mm-hmm.
I was standing between the row of ministers and the barricades up on Lee Park, and with the Nazi, KKK Nazi folks facing where I was. I'm calling them KKK Nazis, Knazis.
Okay.
They're walking toward me, and I didn't step out aside. I stood straight in the middle of the street with my arms gently open, with my shirt saying love, and they just passed right by. And
mm-hmm.
I'm absolutely sure that was white privilege. Had I been a person of
mm-hmm.
color, I'm pretty
absolutely.
Sure I would have been beaten up like that poor special ed teacher who was beaten.
Yeah.
However, I used that white privilege, and I think that's something that's incumbent upon every white person to do, is to use that skin color to make a good difference in our society, to say that we are one people,
mm.
and love is the only way to
yeah.
change the earth. So anyway, they parted like the Red Sea. They just parted around me. I went up to this guy, Danny, and I said, hey, look down at me. Look at me. And I said, give me a hug. I need a hug. And I think you do, too. Mm. So he looked down, and he actually did give me a hug. Mm. And then I said, I think we need another hug. And he gave me another hug, and then another. And then finally he sort of calmed down, and I said, you know, this is only one day in our lives. This is one day. You're making a stand here. You're making a witness against fascism, and that's great. You need to do it calmly so that other people feel that they can come too.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, will you please hand me? And he was looking in my eyes at this point. He was looking in my eyes. He was calmed down. I said, will you please give me your weapon? Mm-hmm. And he said, no, I need it. I need it. And I said, you don't. You don't. What we need is love. And he gave me his two pieces of his stick. And I took them and threw them away. And I kept, when I'd see him, I would go ahead and move forward. And I would kind of stand next to him and continue to be a little bit, you know, like just next to him, try to calm him down a little bit, because he was kind of a wild card.
Yeah, yeah,
and
yeah.
And not in control of his behavior, mm-hmm. which was something that made me sad. That was happening, unfortunately, a little too often that day. And I was pleased to see that the counter demonstrators, we had medical tents and we had food and water, lots of food and water. They were very careful to make sure everybody had food and water, and there was the medical tent was very well run. They knew what they were doing. When I was up in the tree looking over at the Kanazi people, they did not have, I didn't see any medical tent. I didn't see any food or water being given. When I ended up helping these Nazis who were hurt, they didn't seem to have water. Some of them had personal, like one personal container of water, and were a little leery about giving it up to wash the faces of these men who'd been tear gassed or pepper sprayed or whatever. Right. So, but yeah, there were a lot of people doing, you know, really trying to show some love and trying to help these men see that what they were doing was really not loving. I saw one man stumble out of their crowd and go to the side into this little alley. And he was clearly hurt. He was stumbling. His eyes were closed, and he had some blood on his hands, probably from punching some of us. Mm-hmm. And I have a training as an emergency medical technician, and I also was trained as a physical therapy assistant. So I have these skills. So I went ahead and went in to the alley, and you know they had already set up sort of a military like perimeter with people, and I basically just stepped through saying I'm an EMT, and I just stepped through and they let me through. So then when I got into that perimeter, the guy had stumbled onto the ground, and I called for somebody to give me some water. I didn't have any on me at the time. So I called for somebody to give me some water. Somebody brought me water. I was trying to tear gas out of his eyes. And then somebody else stumbled in, somebody else. It was like this. I don't know. They just kept coming. There were about five or six of them, I think, at the height of when I was there with them. And the last guy who stumbled in, and it was interesting because I could feel some of them looking at me. They were reading my shirt, which said love.
Mm-hmm.
And I think some of them could tell, and also some of them might have recognized me from being up in the tree because I was pretty obvious spot. But So then finally this guy stumbled in with a huge gash in his head, just running with blood. And he stumbled down, and I, in good old triage fashion, I went directly to him. Mm-hmm. And I was pressing with my hand, putting direct pressure on his hand, and asking somebody for gauze, asking for a medic, asking for more water for him, because he also had tear gas on his face. So I was holding his pressure on his head and trying to wash his face, and he was thirsty, so I was giving him water to drink and just trying to calm him and help him.
Now, would you agree that though being prepared, I guess, for in the cases of emergency / defending yourself, that's different than being an aggressor, right?
Absolutely.
Would you agree? Okay.
And I think that's one of the things that I saw, mm-hmm. and have seen, is that some people are itching for a fight. Mm-hmm. And that's not helpful, because not only does that not teach a Klan person that there's a better way, but it also it runs other people who would be willing to show up as counter demonstrators if they thought that things were going to be pretty much nonviolent.
Ms. Mary, and for those who maybe just be tuning in, we are talking to Mrs. Mary Graber Grace. She was a first aid responder on August 12th here in Charlottesville, Virginia. But one of the things that stood out to me is how you mentioned that some of the guys, you know, some of the Kanazis, as you called them, and I like that term, you may want to get that trademarked.
No, everybody's welcome to use it. Kanazis. And one of the reasons I like that is because it sounds Jewish, and they'll hate that.
Brilliant. That's brilliant. One thing I was thinking is you mentioned how some of them had suits and ties on. And the fact is, you know, a lot of times leaders are the ones with the prestige, the money, the education. And then a lot of times their followers are a lot of times uneducated, you know, and they're sort of a sheep being led to the slaughter, so to speak.
Exactly. So look at that in the whole community. It's really modeled on our capitalist exploiting the people. Our society does that too. So they've just taken it. They're just trying to pull hate into a mainstream way. And another thing that I really wanted to talk about was trying to get nonviolence trainings for the people. So in general, I'd love to see people trained in active nonviolence. It's not a wimpy thing to stand in front of somebody who has a weapon or who is ready to hurt you. It's not an easy thing, I think it's a really important thing, and I think it's people recognize that that's brave. Like, I think when I climbed that tree, I think I gained some credibility with those guys, and like when I got down, my pen had fallen out of my pocket, and they were just like, yeah, here you go. I mean, I think bravery comes in a lot of different ways. I don't consider myself brave. I feel like I have to do what I have to do.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. So the one other question I have for you, and I'll kick it over to Max to close out with what she has. When we look at how these guys are blatant, and I say guys very generically because, you know, there were females as well. But when we look at these guys who are just blatant out, it reminds you of pre-civil rights era, but unfortunately nowadays and over the past several decades, it's been very institutionalized. You know, there's been laws put in place, there's been discrimination, whether it be housing, whether it be for economic development, whether it's education, to where there is white supremacy, there's racism behind the scenes. So
in front of the scenes.
Yeah, you know, so but my question to you is that, like, how do you feel that we could tackle that? Because a lot of the community, you know, feels like that these issues have been in Charlottesville forever. You know, it's just that there's symbolism now that, you know, that's being used to show it. You know, but for those who feel like that every day in Charlottesville, there is a level of discrimination. You know, how can we fight that?
Well, I think organizing. Like, Virginia Organizing is an incredibly good group. There have got to be so many different groups.
The black gentleman who collected the Klan's robes, his name is Daryl Davis, and he's been a guest here on this show. And so I guess the point I'd like to make is that I took a page right out of his handbook when I spoke with him. He's responsible for dismantling the Maryland chapter of the KKK, and he got a ton of backlash for making friends with them. He actually loaned his bus to them to go to their Klan rallies, right? But what he told us was, and we're extremely judgmental when it comes to this because we like to tell one another how we should handle things as far as
right.
Yeah. So he said, don't tell me how to make my change, right? As long as I'm making, and I realize that's subjective, right? But if you are working towards the equity of people, then that's how you know you're making a good change. Don't tell me how to make my change. I'll make mine, you make yours, and it's all for the common good.
Yes, and everybody has a different passion, you know? I mean, somebody who's out there just working for, like, Fight for 15, or somebody who's out there working on homeless issues, somebody who's out there working, you know, I mean, different on feminism. There are so many different ways that people can show their passion and live their passion, but just do something.
Absolutely.
Don't sit on the couch and watch the news sometimes.
Absolutely. There you go.
Do something and be something and
yes.
make a difference because
yes.
everybody makes a difference, good or bad. So yeah, that's a really good point that everybody has their own gifts. Everybody has their own way to do things. And I personally, of course, you know, I'm going to tout my own opinion because I think we all think our opinions are true. Mm-hmm. I really firmly believe that we need to get trained in nonviolence and share that and really show up en masse, turning our backs on these guys and standing in silence.
That's right. Well, thank you again, Mary Grace, for joining us. You're tuned in to In My Humble Opinion on 101 Jams. Thanks for all that you do. Thank you for your work on August the 12th. We appreciate you.
Thank you. I love the name of the show.
Oh, thank you.
Take care.
You too.
Best of the family.
Thank you. You too, Charles. Bye-bye. Love you.